Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Beaks, Bones, and Bird Songs: How the Struggle for Survival Has Shaped Birds and Their Behavior, by Roger Lederer. Narrated by Charles Constant. Foreword. I'm a birder, so I'm biased, but I think birds are the most wonderfully diverse, unfailingly fascinating creatures on the planet. With more than 10,000 species, birds encompass almost every possibility of shape, lifestyle, niche, design, and environment. There are hummingbirds scarcely bigger than bees, and flightless cassowaries that stand as tall as a human, with a kick that can kill a person, though they rarely do. Birds of paradise shimmer with color and cascades of gauzy plumage. Nightjars blend so well with the dead leaves of the forest floor that one must almost step on them to see them. For the benefit of his mate, a male great argus, a pheasant from Southeast Asia, fans his immense specialized wing feathers and long tail to create a mesmerizing half-circle of silver from which hundreds of iridescent gold eye spots seem to glare. Birds are found from the North Pole to the fringes of Antarctica, from steamy Bornean rainforests to the driest deserts on Earth. Seabirds crisscross the vastness of the world's oceans effortlessly. Some albatrosses, in the half-decade or more before they are old enough to breed, may clock 100,000 miles in a single year, wandering the gale-raked seas of the southern hemisphere. Birds eclipse even the highest mountains on the planet, flying over, not around, the Himalayas at nearly 30,000 feet. Imagine sitting on the wing of an airplane instead of inside the pressurized cabin, in sub-zero temperatures, gasping for breath in the low oxygen atmosphere. And now imagine exerting yourself like a sprinter running a 4-minute mile. That's what some cranes do, twice a year. I've been privileged to study wild birds for many years, exploring the lives and movements of some of the most interesting groups. For 2 decades, I've led a study of the migration of the northern saw-whet owl, a tiny raptor that weighs about as much as a robin and is so infrequently seen that many birders go a lifetime without encountering one. When we started studying these owls in the mountains of Pennsylvania, saw-whets were thought to be so rare that they were the symbol of the State Wildlife Conservation Fund. But by stretching our whisper-thin nets in the woods at night each autumn and playing the weird tooting call of the male saw-whet, we catch them by the hundreds or more. One remarkable season, we netted almost 4,000 of them, traveling south from the boreal forests of Canada. Another group I've been working with for years are hummingbirds, which add zip and color to backyards from the Rio Grande to Alaska. Science has peeled back many of the mysteries of these minute dynamos. Their extraordinary physiological abilities, their epic migrations, their ferocious metabolisms. But we still have a lot to learn. I've worked with colleagues across the continent to explore the way that some Western hummingbird species, most notably the rufous hummingbird of the Pacific Northwest, are rapidly evolving new migratory routes and new wintering areas in the east and southeast. Each winter, yes, winter, we catch and band dozens of vagrant hummingbirds, which happily tolerate temperatures well below freezing in the middle of northeastern winters. One hardy rufous hummingbird has been documented surviving nighttime temperatures down to minus 9 degrees Fahrenheit, with wind chills below minus 30 degrees Fahrenheit. That's amazing for any animal, much less one that weighs slightly more than a penny. How do they survive? These hummingbirds have the ability to drastically lower their body temperature at night, essentially going into a nightly hibernation to conserve energy, then emerging from torpor at first light and resuming their hunt for tree sap, winter-active insects, and other food. All this is by way of whetting your appetite for what you'll find in this book. Educator, birder, and ornithologist Roger Lederer is your guide through the myriad and often almost miraculous ways that birds live their varied lives. From avian senses to communication, flight to physiology, migration to sex, the whole range of bird life and natural history is here. You'll learn how birds react to hurricanes, that goldfinches double the density of their plumage for winter, why their small size makes thieves of calliope hummingbirds, and how, in a sense, urban birds understand posted speed limits for automobiles perhaps better than human drivers. I've had the pleasure of birding with Roger on his home ground in the mountains and river valleys of California. Under his entertaining tutelage, you'll never look at birds the same way again. And you may see that it is not bias, but a simple fact. Birds really are the most fascinating animals on Earth. Scott Whitensall, author of Living on the Wind and other books. Introduction. It's tough to be a bird. There are some 4 million different kinds of animals and plants in the world. 4 million different solutions to the problems of staying alive. David Attenborough. Look outside your window, take a walk, go fishing, watch a video, or do anything else that allows you to see birds in the wild. You may get the impression that birds are blithely going about their business, happily chirping, singing, and scratching among the leaves, flitting from branch to branch, clambering up a tree trunk, or soaring through the sky, barely moving a feather. Looks like an easy life. Cultural symbols like the dove representing peace, the bluebird signifying happiness, and the robin as the harbinger of spring reinforce the idea that birds have not a care in the world. But we don't often see the arduous challenges a bird faces every moment of every day. Of the many hours I have spent in the field watching birds flying, feeding, resting, and nesting, I was most affected by those moments when I saw birds searching for food in blowing snow, sitting on the surface of an ocean fighting threatening waves, and flying in serious winds. I wondered, how do birds make it from hatching to adulthood and from year to year after that? Birds have to be on task all the time. They have to use their senses to find food, migrate, withstand the weather, avoid predators, compete with each other and alien species, and face a myriad of other trials. This book is about the abilities, adaptations, and behaviors birds possess and employ to survive from one day to the next. It is only the most physiologically, anatomically, and behaviorally well-tuned birds who successfully meet these challenges and go on to the most important goal in their life, reproduction. The phrase free as a bird implies a carefree existence and the liberty to go anywhere, anytime. But birds are not as free as their aerial life implies. Accurate figures for mortality and longevity of wild birds are nearly impossible to determine, but there are trends. Only about 50% of white-eyed vireos in the southeastern United States return to their breeding grounds from their winter quarters, and merely 36% of downy woodpeckers, resident all year throughout much of North America, survive from one year to the next. Songbird adults have a 40 to 60% survival rate from year to year. Of their young, perhaps only 10% make it from egg to adulthood the following year. This means that a 2-year-old songbird is a 1 out of 20 miracle. This short life expectancy is a result of the many dangers birds face. And while bigger birds have a lower mortality rate than smaller birds, they all face hazards every day. Unlike humans, birds don't seem to get closer to their demise as they age. Instead of slowly declining, most birds, after reaching maturity, have an equal chance of dying suddenly at all times of their precarious life. Sick or injured birds are rarely seen in the wild, as illness or injury puts them at immediate risk of death, so you only see healthy birds on your bird walks. Evolution has been at work on birds for more than 200 million years, shaping them into adept and adroit organisms. But birds today not only face the challenges that natural selection throws at them, but an entirely new set of obstacles, thanks to us. Things started to change for birds shortly after humans came on the scene. Early humans incorporated birds into their diet. Then agriculture came along, usurping habitat but also inadvertently providing food for birds. As civilization matured, bird feathers, bills, and bones became adornment for human culture. Later, birds were domesticated for meat or eggs. Bird hunting became more efficient with the advent of guns, and as civilization spread, habitat shrank. Massive destruction of wildlife of all sorts was common, including the commercial hunting of many bird species for food and feathers, until the passage of the Lacey Act in the United States in 1900, the first federal law protecting wildlife. The Migratory Bird Treaty Act of 1918 further protected migratory birds. These laws made a difference in North America, but many bird species live in or migrate through areas of the world that don't pay much attention to the needs of birds or their protection. Today, about 1,400 of the world's 10,000 bird species are threatened with extinction. We have destroyed habitats and replaced them with cities, highways, tall windowed buildings, transmission towers and lines, microwave antennas, wind turbines, and lights, along with millions of cats. Birds have always contracted diseases, but humans have altered the environment and allowed pathogens to spread more quickly. A solar plant in the Mojave Desert concentrates the sun's rays so strongly that birds are incinerated if they happen to fly through it. Birds have evolved rather amazing and often unique adaptations to the environment, but as the world changed, those adaptations became increasingly less effective. Birds never evolved defenses against windows or lights, buildings or towers, or the large number of our feline friends. Climate change has caused changes in bird migration patterns, but what the long-term effect will be is unknown. With ornithological science as the background, this book will explore the common and unusual ways birds put into operation their physical and behavioral adaptations. What everyday challenges does a bird face, and how does it survive? Seeing ultraviolet, finding food without seeing or touching it, flying thousands of miles non-stop, maneuvering deftly and speedily through thick forests, navigating by smell, surviving extremes of weather, sharing community resources, and changing their songs in noisy cities are just some of the amazing things birds do to simply make it to tomorrow and cope with the challenges of a changing planet. Birds' beaks and bellies. The whys and wherefores of foraging. In birds, the mouth consists of what is called the beak, which in them is a substitute for lips and teeth. This beak presents variations in harmony with the functions and protective purposes which it serves. Aristotle, On the Parts of Animals. Ever watch birds jockeying for position to snatch the best morsels of seed at a bird feeder? The same phenomenon occurs in the woods, but is not as easily observed as it happens in a much larger venue with a wider variety of birds and food items. Foraging, from the Old French fourras, to forage, pillage, or plunder, refers to the ways birds find food. This activity, followed by feeding, consumes much of a bird's day, and for good reason. Efficient foraging is indispensable for survival. Birds have many other challenges, weather, predators, competitors, migratory journeys, on their way to their fundamental goal of reproduction, but these only add to the burden of finding food. The feeding behavior of birds has been studied for many years, but in the 1960s, ornithologists recognized that birds that maximize their energy intake per unit time spent foraging produce the most offspring. Those birds that ate foodstuffs with less nutritional value or spent too much or not enough time seeking food are no longer with us. As a result of this revelation, the importance of foraging in avian ecology has been reflected in a large percentage of field studies ever since. Successful foraging is the result of beak or bill, the terms are interchangeable, shape, which in turn determines much of a bird's lifestyle. The beak, with few exceptions, is the bird's only tool. Birds use their beak not only to forage and feed, but also to preen and oil feathers, defend territories, attack predators, build nests, and aid in courtship displays. So if it is an all-around tool, why aren't all bird bills the same? Some perfect, all-purpose beak created by evolution? Because natural selection, in its wise ways, reduced competition by making different bills for different foods. the evolution from teeth to beak, the ultimate tool. Rare as hen's teeth has come to mean rarity itself. Of all the vertebrate groups, fish, amphibians, reptiles, birds, and mammals, only birds lack teeth as we know them, enamel outcroppings fixed in jaws. About 150 million years ago in the Jurassic period, there lived an almost perfect example of the transition between reptiles and birds, an animal with rooted teeth, a long, bony tail, and the abdominal ribs of reptiles, but also feathers. This animal, Archaeopteryx, or ancient wing, is certainly among the most important fossils ever found and for many years was considered to be the first bird. However, since its discovery in 1861, many other fossils of potential bird ancestors have been uncovered, such as the Chinese fossil Xiaotingia zenghi, discovered in 2011. Many early birds shared major skeletal characteristics with Celerosaurian or hollow-tailed lizard dinosaurs, forwardly located pelvic or hip bones, large bony eye sockets, light hollow bones, reduced tail vertebrae, elongated arms and hands, and fused clavicles, making the wishbone. They also shared a similar egg structure and had some feathers. As birds evolved, improvements in flying ability required morphological changes, such as the need to weigh less. Teeth became smaller and reduced in number until they finally disappeared. Lighter bills, both hooked and serrated, replaced heavier teeth. Along with bills, birds developed other ways to grasp prey, such as tongues and feet with spines or prickles. Whereas toothed mammals chew food to begin digestion, birds simply snatch and quickly swallow food like insects, nectar, fruit, worms, and seeds. To accommodate these changes, the feeding mechanisms of birds became specialized not only in the form of beaks, but further down, bellies, or crops and gizzards. A bird's beak is composed of an upper and lower bony jaw covered by a thick layer of keratin, a structural protein, the same substance that forms skin, feathers, scales, fingernails, and turtle shells. This is the rhemphotheca, Greek for beak case or sheath, which grows throughout the year, sometimes changing color seasonally as it does in the European starling, whose wintry black bill becomes yellow in the spring. Beaks, which evolved for the purpose of food getting, are as varied in shape and size as ice cream flavors, reflecting the diversity of food and its source. Beaks range in size from the African shoebill's enormous wooden shoe-shaped beak to the minuscule beaks of small finches. Hooked, long, thick, wide, pointed, blunt, up or downturned, bent, crossed, swollen, or serrated, beaks tear, probe, suck, filter, chip, crack, tweeze, chisel, crush, strain, spear, or seize food items. Along with differing shapes, styles, and lengths of beaks came different feeding styles. Heavy conical bills handle seeds well, whereas flat triangular beaks catch flies easily. Crossbills use their overlapping mandibles for opening pine cones. Long-billed shorebirds probe deeply into mud flats, locating their quarry without seeing, touching, or smelling it. And skimmers slice through the top of the ocean's waters, snatching food items near the surface. Every bird has its own beak-defined niche. A flycatcher could not survive by feeding on mudflats any more than a sandpiper could live in thick woods. Bills often serve as sexual signals as well. Male zebra finches with bright bills attract females, as do puffins with their multicolored beaks. Bird bills also help to regulate body temperature by radiating heat, partially compensating for birds' lack of sweat glands. So sometimes there is a bit of a compromise among the functions of the bill, but eating is the highest priority. Consider the finches of the Galapagos Island and their bill shapes. An ancestral finch or two landed on the Galapagos from South or Central America. The birds increased in number and spread to different islands until eventually 14 different species with beak variations came to be. Three species of finches eat seeds off the ground. Three more live on cactuses and eat mainly fruit and insects, and one seed-eater lives in trees. The rest are arboreal insect eaters, including the tool-using woodpecker finch that extracts insect larvae from tree branches with the use of a cactus spine. Evolving a different beak meant exploiting a new food source and sharing the food supply, which benefited everyone. Every bird has its own technique of seeking out and acquiring sustenance, with beak shape defining a range of behaviors and food items. Since we are most familiar with the birds that visit our feeders, let's start with the seed eaters. Seed eaters, or granivores. Granivory, or seed and grain eating, evolved in tandem with birds developing the ability to fly, as seeds provide accessible sources of concentrated energy. The lower jaws of granivores are solidly muscularized, enabling the jaw to push the seed upward into the almost immovable upper jaw. The hard palate of the upper jaw is heavily keratinized and has ridges, bumps, and spine-like projections that serve to husk the seed and direct the digestible part backward. Seeds are not easy to digest, so after the seeds are swallowed, they move to the crop. From the Old English, crop, meaning craw, an expanded part of the esophagus. Most bird species have a crop, but some, like owls and geese, do not. The crop may have evolved as part of the active lifestyle of some birds. Fossil evidence from China indicates that perhaps as far back as 140 million years ago, some birds had crops for temporary food storage, as did some herbivorous dinosaurs. Rather than eating food slowly and digesting it before moving on, birds with a crop fill it to almost bursting. Digestion then begins as the food slowly makes its way downward. I once found a dead grouse with a fist-sized crop full of juniper needles. Veterinarian Thomas Cacciasi dissected a wood duck and found 10 decent-sized acorns in its crop. That would be like a human throat filled with 10 golf balls. From the crop, the food goes to the small intestine, and then the glandular part of the stomach that secretes digestive enzymes, the proventriculus, or before the small belly. The second part of the stomach is the ventriculus, small belly, or gizzard, from the Old French zaisier, meaning chicken entrails. The gizzard is muscular and, substituting for teeth, mechanically grinds food. It often contains sand grains or small rocks to help in the process. Apparently, this organ has fascinated people for years. Spallanzani, an Italian Catholic priest of the 18th century, claimed that he fed turkeys scalpel blades, which the gizzard ground to pieces. Some say that if you hold a live chicken up to your ear, you can hear gizzard stones grinding. From the basic conical shape, seed-eater bills vary to match the contours of seeds and their different sizes, shapes, and hardness. Deeper bills have more musculature and exert greater forces, so in general, the deeper the bill, the larger the seed that can be handled. Evening grosbeaks, so named by French explorers who thought the birds only fed in the evening, have a large bill that can exert enough force to crack open cherry pits. Following robins and other cherry eaters that digest the fruit and regurgitate the seeds, evening grosbeaks feast on the pits. The European hawfinch can crack open olive and plum pits as well and feeds its young by regurgitating partially digested seeds. Birds typically choose the seeds that are most available and easily handled. At a bird feeder, you might find white-crowned sparrows gingerly manipulating seeds to husk them, Eurasian collared doves gulping larger seeds, and tiny goldfinches picking through the seed pile for smaller, softer seeds. Finches place the seed laterally on the edge of their lower jaw and slide their jaw slightly forward and back to crack it. To husk it, the bird moves the seed to the middle of the palate and moves its jaw laterally until the shell comes off. Watch the dining habits of these birds at your feeder closely and you'll discover lots of different styles, like your relatives at Thanksgiving dinner. The red crossbill is a specialist. Its crossed mandibles and strong jaws enable the bird to pry open the scales of pine cones and extract the small seeds. The bird holds a cone with one foot while extracting a seed. Interestingly, individuals with the lower mandible crossed to the right hold the cone with their right foot, and left-crossed birds use their left foot. This adaptation gives crossbills almost exclusive access to this particular seed source, but specialization has its downside. As seed removal takes time, crossbills need seed abundances 2 or 3 times greater than other bird species to fill their daily energy requirements as they have less time to forage. The production of seeds in coniferous forests goes down every 3 to 5 years, at which time the crossbills are at a disadvantage competing for other kinds of seeds that they can't handle as well. Acorn woodpeckers of the western United States and Mexico store acorns in granary trees and defend them aggressively. They wedge the acorns into holes in trees or wooden telephone poles so tightly that crows, squirrels, and rats can't raid their supply. To remove an acorn, a woodpecker hammers it with its bill to crack the shell and extract the meat. Clark's nutcrackers, capable of carrying more than 90 pine seeds at a time in a pouch under their tongue, store many of them in caches, even under the snow. They cache 2 or 3 times what they need for the winter, and eventually find half or more of their seed caches later. Not only do the birds recall the site of these caches for up to 9 months, they also remember the relative number of seeds and the size of the seeds in each cache. Florida scrub jays cache food by burying one acorn at a time. If they observe another jay, a potential cache robber, watching them, they will return later to move the acorn. But they will only do this if they themselves were cache robbers in the past. Seems that honest jays trust the other ones, and thieves do not. The grazers, big, small, flying, and flightless. Lots of birds are grazers, and some of them are considered crop pests. Blackbirds in North America and Java sparrows in Indonesia eat rice crops, while parrots damage almond crops in Australia. The red-billed quillia of Africa may be one of the worst pests because, some say, it is the most abundant bird in the world. Super colonies of an estimated 30 million birds have been observed. Flocks are so large that when they land in trees, they break large limbs off. A large flock of quillia can eat 50 tons of grain a day, and since quillia are kept as pets in Australia, Queensland Biosecurity is concerned about their possible escape and damage to corn, wheat, and cereal crops. One quillia adaptation for survival is the behavior of breaking up into small search parties to hunt for food and then returning to the colony to transmit information about the new food source. Studies indicate, perhaps not surprisingly, that the number of birds and variety of bird species that feed on food crops is much higher in organically grown fields than in non-organic ones. The numbers of insects as well as weedy plants are also double or triple in organic crop fields because of the absence of pesticides. While fishing on my favorite lake, I admired the numerous Canada, not Canadian, geese overhead, on the water, and in the shoreline grass. Once in serious decline in the early 20th century because of overhunting and habitat destruction, their current North American population may be nearly 6 million. The birds graze on grass blades, stems, and seeds, grasping the plants with the lamellae or sharp ridges of their bills. Not possessing a crop, they eat constantly, and the not-so-nutritious food, with a large amount of minimally digestible cellulose, moves quickly through their digestive system. This results in a lot of bird pooping, about every 20 minutes, a big reason the birds are considered pests on school grounds, parks, and golf courses. The flightless kakapo, or owl parrot from New Zealand, is also a dedicated vegetarian, regurgitating indigestible fiber. It has a small gizzard for a plant eater, probably because its jaw, tongue, and beak structure allow it to grind up plant matter before swallowing. Unusual among land birds, the kakapo can also store a large amount of body fat, making it the world's heaviest parrot. It is also the world's rarest parrot and perhaps the longest-lived bird at an estimated 90 years. Grouse and ptarmigan digest about a fifth of the fiber they eat. If they had evolved a fermentation chamber as part of their digestive system, they would be able to process more, but that would add weight to these birds, which are already weak flyers. Adding a fermentation chamber allowed the evolution of flightless birds such as the ostrich, emu, and rheas. These large ground dwellers graze on green plants and seeds, digesting much of the cellulose they ingest by fermenting it in their cecum, comparable to our appendix. The efficient gut of the emu has a muscular gizzard with a strong grinding ability, aided by grit. In addition to small stones in the gizzard, pieces of glass, wood, and metal are occasionally found, and an acid environment. These birds prefer high-energy foods, such as fruit and seeds, and are able to extract enough energy from plant stems to support up to 2/3 of their daily energy needs. Ostriches, whose gizzards might contain 3 pounds of material, have been known to eat rings, bottle caps, spark plugs, bicycle valves, and even pieces of baling wire. However, they do not eat tin cans or hide their heads in the sand. Gleaners, hawkers, and probers. Three ways to eat bugs. Another major food source is bugs, really arthropods, of every stripe. Spiders, flies, millipedes, ants, beetles, and relatives. Birds catch these nutritious creatures in three ways: gleaning, hawking, or probing. Gleaners. Gleaning is a type of foraging strategy in which birds pick bugs off the ground, leaves, rocks, or tree trunks. Many gleaning birds, such as tits and kinglets, flutter, hop, hang, or hover glean in the foliage as they pluck at their prey. Warblers make their way through a tree, nipping bugs off leaves, while thrushes and towhees move along the ground, scratching for prey items among the litter. Verdins of the southwestern United States and Mexico use their strong feet to pull leaves toward them or hang upside down to inspect the undersides for tiny prey. They will also eat a larger food item such as a caterpillar by grasping it under one foot and consuming it piece by piece. Black-capped chickadees don't just move around randomly hoping to find insects. They find caterpillar prey by searching for leaves damaged by caterpillars. They look for dry, curled leaves or tree branches and inspect them, distinguishing between caterpillars that have fed on trees with toxic or distasteful substances, such as tannins or glycosides, and palatable prey. After finding a caterpillar, black-capped chickadees will often hang upside down by one foot while pecking at the larva held in the other foot. Although the gleaning group is generally composed of small insectivorous birds, many other birds glean. Woodpeckers, quail, grackles, crows, robins, gulls, pigeons, and turkeys. Some have unusual food sources. Oxpeckers of Africa glean parasites like ticks off the back of various ungulates like giraffes and rhinos. The assumption for many years was that this was a case of mutualism. The birds got food, and the hoofed animals were rid of skin parasites. However, a new study determined that only 15% of the time that birds spent on the back of ungulates is devoted to devouring ticks. The rest of the time, the birds feed on skin wounds, earwax, and other goodies found by probing through the hair. Cattle egrets follow in the footsteps of buffalo, wildebeest, zebra, or cattle, feeding on the invertebrates the mammals scare up. It is clearly profitable, as the cattle following egrets spend 2/3 the amount of energy and get up to 3 times as much food in a given amount of time as do egrets that forage in the absence of cattle. The birds tend to follow ungulates that walk at a moderate pace, because a slower speed does not stir up enough insects and a faster pace hurries their feeding. Other birds have more indirect methods of gleaning insects. House sparrows have learned the trick of waiting in a highway diner's parking lot to glean the freshly killed insects off the grills and radiators of cars. Boat-tailed grackles have been observed doing the same thing in the parking lot of the Kennedy Space Center in Florida. Great-tailed grackles survive in Death Valley, California by picking insects off the license plates of tourists' cars. The grills and radiators are presumably too hot. Hawkers. Hawking birds fly out from a perch, snatch a bug, and then return to the branch or post. Also called sallying or fly catching, this technique is a good way of making a living, as evidenced by hundreds of species of birds. The flycatcher family, Tyrannidae, is the most diverse family of birds with more than 400 species, including the smallest songbird in the world, such as the pygmy tyrants, and the species with the longest tail relative to body size of any bird, the fork-tailed flycatcher. The black phoebe, a common flycatcher resident of the southwestern United States and Central America, sits on a low branch near a creek or pond and waits for a flying insect such as a bee, wasp, or beetle to approach. After flying out and snapping its hooked-tip bill down on the bug, the bird will eat it in midair, or if the bug is big, take it back to the perch and whack it on the branch a few times to kill it. Flycatchers, like many birds in temperate regions, choose their prey by size. The largest flycatchers eat the largest insects, the smallest flycatcher the smallest, and the medium-sized birds take intermediate-sized prey. My PhD thesis was a study of the foraging habits and diet of 7 species of flycatchers in different habitats. After doing the requisite library research, I discovered that most ornithologists thought that flycatchers swept insects into their bills with their long rictal bristles, modified feathers on either side of the jaw. But because no evidence supported this idea, I captured flycatchers, put them in a large flight cage, and filmed the birds at 400 frames per second as they caught flies in mid-air. Viewed at normal speed, the films showed the birds snapping up flies in the tips of their rapidly closing bills, with the help of a small downward hook on the upper bill. Rictal bristles played no direct role. Later anatomical studies indicated that these bristles have sensory connections to the brain that probably help the bird determine speed and orientation in flight. Swifts are successful and abundant around the world, numbering about 100 species. With their thin, knife-like wings emanating from a cigar-shaped body and their rudimentary tails, swifts resemble a boomerang. They lead an aerial lifestyle, feeding, drinking, mating, and even sleeping on the wing. They rarely stop except to build a nest. Their feet are so small that they cannot perch, but instead cling to vertical walls when they do rest. They were once lumped with the hummingbirds into the order Apodiformes. Apodi means without feet. Normally feeding at moderate heights, swifts may go as high as 3,000 feet to feed. While raising young, a pair of white-throated swifts might bring as many as 5,000 arthropods to their nestlings each day. Swallows, which have somewhat wider wings and longer tails, are aerial feeders, although they will occasionally swoop down to pluck insects off the ground or the surface of a lake. They tend to fly fairly close to the ground and choose larger insects than swifts, but avoid stinging ones like wasps and bees. Swallows perch regularly on wires or tree branches to rest, and occasionally land on the ground, although they walk only awkwardly. In times of insect scarcity, swallows will partake of fruit. The greater striped swallow of Africa even eats acacia seeds and feeds them to its nestlings. The similarly shaped but larger nighthawks and relatives are crepuscular feeders, venturing out in the evening when flying insects are abundant. Their bills are small, barely noticeable, but their open jaws reveal a huge, sticky mouth. Nighthawks and relatives are sometimes referred to as goat suckers because their wide mouth was once thought to allow the birds to suckle on the teats of goats. Flying low and slow with seemingly erratic wing beats, nighthawks scoop insects into their open jaws and rapidly send them down the gullet, catching a few thousand insects in an evening. The honey guides of Africa, family Indicatoridae, is an unusual group of insect eaters, although they are actually omnivorous. They guide humans, such as the Boran tribe of East Africa, to bee colonies. The Boran people whistle to the birds to attract them, and the birds respond by signaling the humans with chattering sounds, flying a short distance and calling again until the hive is reached. The humans take the honey, and the birds get the bee eggs, larvae, pupae, and beeswax. Everybody eats. Probers. Probers poke their beaks into large and small crevices to extract invertebrate morsels. The brown creeper of North America is a small bird with a sharp, down-curved bill. Flying to the base of a tree, it works its way upward, spiraling around the trunk, searching under and around the bark for insects, their larvae or eggs, and other small creatures. Its long claws and spiky tail feathers move the bird upward as it clings close to the tree, appearing to be a piece of bark. Nuthatches operate similarly, but with a sharp, straight bill, a short tail, and a habit of starting at the top of the tree and working their way down. Although mainly insectivorous, nuthatches get their name from hatching, cracking nuts and seeds open with their sharp bill. Like a few other birds, nuthatches will cache food, both insects and seeds, but typically with only one type of food item per cache. Woodpeckers probe by sticking their bills deep into crevices, whether tree bark, roof shingles, or the ground. A most interesting arrangement allows the tongue to extend out perhaps 4 times the length of the beak. Some woodpecker tongues cover the hyoid apparatus, a series of muscle-covered bones in the shape of a Y, with the horns of the Y originating forward of the nostrils, or in the orbits of the eyes, looping over and down the skull, coming together as one bone in the throat and extending out between the jaws as the tongue. Depending on the species, the tongue may be sticky, have barbs or spines, or be flattened at the end. Pecking and probing, woodpeckers also pound, and the perennial question is why they don't get headaches. 3 reasons. The skull is a sponge-like matrix of bones that helps to absorb blows. The lower jaw bends a bit, lessening the shock, and the hyoid bone acts like a seatbelt, preventing excess movement of the head. New helmets for army tank drivers and bicyclists are being designed based upon the ingenuity of this woodpecker trait. Shorebirds have made probing a real science, probing into the mud for invertebrates such as worms, insect larvae, amphipods, crustaceans, and mollusks. Their bills go shallow, deep, or somewhere in between, divvying up the food sources by depth. Short-billed plovers probe down to a depth of 2 inches. Medium-billed stilts feed at intermediate depths, and the long-billed curlews feed from the surface down to 8 inches. How does the curlew find and snatch its prey? Think about how difficult it would be to completely open a long pair of forceps in thick muck. Long-billed shorebirds have figured this out. Only the tips of their bill open and close, sort of like those picker-upper gadgets one uses to collect litter from the curb. Avocets with long upcurved bills sweep their bills side to side through the water or silt in search of prey, or swim to deeper water and dabble head down like ducks. But how do shorebirds find food in the first place, being that it might be buried in sand and muck? Recent research has shown that many shorebirds, such as the western and least sandpipers and the red knot, can detect prey under the sand of the shoreline without seeing, smelling, or touching it. Herbst corpuscules, mechanosensory organs just underneath the surface of the bill, are the answer. Sticking their bills less than a half inch into the sand, the birds can detect the presence of a rock or a prey item because the corpuscles detect differences in the pressure gradient. We used to think that the nocturnal kiwi of New Zealand located its worm prey by smell, since its nostrils are located near the tip of the bill and the olfactory lobes of the brain are large. But recent research indicates that kiwis have mechanoreceptors similar to that of shorebirds. Ibises also possess this adaptation, and as the birds are not closely related, these mechanoreceptors must have evolved independently. Oyster catchers live in almost all coastal areas of the world and feed on a wide variety of prey. On land, they probe for worms and insects, and in the shallows, they poke about for marine worms and shelled invertebrates. But their long bills also serve as wedges to pry chitons and limpets off rocks and to crack their shells. Oyster catchers are named for their style of feeding on mussels and oysters by sticking their bills between the valves of a feeding mussel and cutting the posterior adductor muscle to open the shells. Young oyster catchers must learn this technique, often stealing food from adults before their education is complete. Of all the probers, hummingbirds and sunbirds are probably the most recognized. Sticking their beak deeply into a flower, they extract nectar with their fringed and grooved tongues. There are 132 species of sunbirds and almost 3 times as many hummingbirds, so this lifestyle is obviously successful. Because birds and flowering plants came into being about the same time, during the Jurassic period about 150 million years ago, flowers and flower-probing birds have a close connection. Many flowers, actually their petals, have adapted a form and function to attract pollinators and reward them with nectar. Hummingbird-pollinated flowers tend to be yellow, orange, or red, have only a mild scent, are above average in nectar concentration and amount of pollen, hang horizontally or downward, and are tubular in shape. Hummingbirds hover and transfer pollen with their beaks. The heliconia, false bird of paradise, flowers of southern hemisphere rainforests, have sticky threads of pollen that adhere to hummingbird bills to make transfer even more efficient. Because hummingbirds feed while airborne, hummingbird-pollinated flowers can be located almost anywhere on the plant. But sunbirds sit while they feed, so sunbird flowers provide a perch. The rat's tail, Babiana ringens, a flowering plant endemic to South Africa, grows a spike specifically as a bird perch. Some sunbird-pollinated flower species bloom close to the ground to make their flower parts more accessible. And since they perch while feeding, sunbirds often transfer the pollen to another plant by transporting it with their feet. Frugivores, the seed dispersers. Animal distribution of pollen is a much more efficient system than wind and exemplifies co-evolution nicely. Pollination leads to fertilization and the development of seeds, which also need to be dispersed, so seeds are often encased in fruit to attract seed dispersers. Birds eat the fruits, and the hard-cased seeds exit the digestive tract or are regurgitated. The plant's seeds get moved away from the parent plant, and the bird gets nutrition. Everybody wins. Fruit eating is common among birds. In one study in Costa Rica, 70 bird species were seen feeding on the fruit of 170 species of plants. Birds choose fruit based upon its nutritional value, seed-to-fruit size ratio, taste, time of ripening, and color. Berries are an important, sometimes sole, source of food in the winter when insects are scarce. The missel thrush of England will defend hollyberry patches, and the Townsend's solitaire of North America will defend stands of juniper trees. The yellow-rumped warbler is the only warbler able to digest waxy myrtle and bayberries, allowing the birds to survive the winter farther north than any other warbler species in North America. Bird-dispersed fruit tends to be red, but may also be blue or black, whereas mammal-dispersed fruit is generally yellow, orange, or brown. You would think that brightly colored fruits would be most appealing to birds because they are to us, but experiments with red wings in Finland indicate that blue fruits are attractive as well because birds see ultraviolet UV light being reflected by some blueberries. In an area with few fruit-eating birds, fruits tend to be multicolored to enhance their attractiveness. Birds that usually eat smaller fruits whole defecate the smaller seeds away from the tree, whereas birds that tend to eat the large seeds of large fruits at or near the tree drop them underneath rather than dispersing them. But since large seeds are more successful at germinating and it takes fewer seeds to establish a new plant, the strategies are more or less equivalent. Most birds pass the seeds a few hours after ingestion, so the seeds are not deposited a great distance from the parent plant. However, two shorebirds, the killdeer and least sandpiper, may retain seeds of bindweed, mallow, and sumac in their guts for 6 to 14 days. As long-distance migrants, these birds may deposit seeds thousands of miles from their origin. Cedar waxwings live mainly on fruit and are so efficient at digesting that they can pass mistletoe and other berries through their digestive tract in 16 minutes. They will gorge themselves, filling their throats and crops with berries until they move down the digestive tract. Sometimes the birds are so satiated that they will pick a berry and pass it down a line of birds until one decides to eat it. The story is often told about waxwings.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.